Back, legal enthusiasts. We are here with another episode of Off the Desk, and today we have with us Mr. Akbar Ahmed. He's a esteemed member of the legal community and alumni of the University of Cambridge, and currently an advocate at the Lucknow bench of the Allahabad High Court.
Great to have you.
Thank you.
I was really very keen to talk to you because my first internship was actually Allahabad High Court, and I had like a very good experience there. I'm assuming you must have had some experience in the Allahabad High Court also, sir.
Let me tell you that I basically started practicing here at the Lucknow bench of the Allahabad High Court recently, a year and a half back on January 2019, I basically started. Before that, I was in Delhi and I went for my LLM. So, in between the time I graduated from law school and before I went for my master's to the University of Cambridge, I was basically working in a firm setup, and thereafter, I was working with a government department just to gain some experience, just to clear my mind what is there to which I would best fit in. So, I'm going to share with you, like I was told before, some experiences. As far as my experience with the Allahabad High Court concerned, I basically practiced it before the Lucknow bench. So I haven't gotten yet to visit Allahabad professionally. Otherwise, obviously, I have been to Allahabad.
Court
On what
essentially,
got
The court essentially, as this is like an intro. This is the court. Allahabad High Court reminds me of that old Delhi ki jo galiyan hoti hai, sir. That old things like the Delhi
That's true.
High Court and all those are newly made. It's very like it's a mall. It has a mall kind of feeling inside. The Allahabad High Court is nice.
See, obviously, it's one of the largest high courts in the entire India, probably the largest bar in the bench here, one of the oldest as well. But if you see the Lucknow bench of it, the 2016 new building is no less compared to a Delhi High Court or any other posh looking infrastructure high court.
I haven't been there,
Yeah,
but yeah, I
you should, you
can.
should.
That's why I wanted to start with asking you that how did you really get into law? Because for me, my school culture, I took science, then I went to the humanities. I started looking at law and I was like, okay, this is something interesting. This is something that's gonna engage my mind. What was it like for you, sir?
Like you had a science background, even I did my schooling with or throughout with science background. I had physics, chemistry, and me as my options, my school. And frankly, law was never the first choice. I was always into very inclined going into medicine. But as luck would have it, I met with an accident when I was giving my boards, so I couldn't really appear for my entrance examinations. And I was never kind of dropping for a year and then again preparing. And after that incident also, so, and I come from a family of lawyers. I'm a third generation lawyer in my family. So obviously, like many other Indian households, the family profession becomes one of the obvious choices. Obviously, it's up to the individual whether they take it or not. But yeah, it becomes one of the obvious choices. And so it was for me. So law was always a second option. But it was always there in my mind. So when all this incident happened, I planned that there's no point wasting an year again. And obviously, competitive examinations, it's your hard work as well as your luck. You might not get into it. So I chose law, and this was back in 2009. So I think a year back only CLAT started. I had no clue about CLAT and this and that. So I And by the time I realized that, okay, I am not going to waste another year sitting for medical entrance examinations and decided to do on law. I think it was already July or something, CLAT and everything was already done for that year. So I landed up in Amity. And it started like this. It wasn't the first choice, but yeah, I'm glad that it happened. And
So essentially, you
Sir,
didn't choose law, but life chose law for you in a certain way. I'm saying you didn't choose law, but life chose law for you in a certain way.
I think it is true with every decision we take in life. I don't think, as far as my life is concerned, I don't think it goes very planned. Like yeah. when I would come to tell you about my decision of opting for higher studies and applying and going to Cambridge, it was also not on the plate, and it wasn't also not on my mind, but it happened.
Right.
So I come from a science background as well. I happen to share the same story as you. So
okay.
when I decided to join law, I had a lot of inhibitions as to how well can I fit in the field. And throughout my experience, it has been like, okay, law is truly a welcoming area of study for all the students, regardless of what background they come from. And I had this preconceived notion as to humanities as subjects like political science, history, which truly helps you in your law career. And I had physics, chemistry, bio too. So, sir, how would you advise aspiring law students to set foot in the field? And is a set of prerequisite knowledge and skills required to do well?
Yeah, that's true. As far as the background is concerned, I think law being one of the facets of social sciences, people who have been into humanities and social sciences and have studied subjects like political science and history back in their schools, obviously they have an added advantage when it comes to their law school part. But mm-hmm. as far as people from science background are concerned, I have experienced that you have a different approach toward everything. Your mind is very practical in that sense.
Right.
So I think law, when it comes to actually practicing law, it really doesn't matter from which background you are. Yeah, obviously it matters till the time you are in law school, and that too initial few years till the time they're teaching you all those bachelor subjects. When it comes into pure law, nobody has a studied contract or for that matter torts in their schools. So it only matters for initial few years. After that, I don't think so it really matters. And as far as people from science background are concerned, law these days with this advancement in technology, I think is also growing. You have cyber crimes, you have forensics, you have medical law. There, and for that matter, intellectual property rights. There, obviously, you have an advantage being from a science background. In fact, even if you want to pursue, say, masters in intellectual property rights, I think, if I'm not mistaken, prestigious institutions like IIT Kharagpur and all, they offer these diplomas and masters, and they have the requisite of person coming from a science background to apply. So, as far as people from science background are concerned, I think they have clear advantage over all these things.
Even
so it doesn't really matter.
Even I feel that because I experienced, I loved science till 10th. Even in 11th, I took science. I was there for like 2-3 months. And then my mind went towards law and I shifted to humanities. But I did find that the person who took PCM, their mind works in a different pattern. They create patterns, they create parallels. And a humanities mind doesn't really work that way. It's more theoretical. It's like a mugging up of knowledge, a little more like that.
See, Abhipriya, let me tell you something. Initially, when there used to be a pattern of a 3-year law course where they would start teaching you law, and persons who have enrolled in that 3-year course have already done their bachelor's in different streams. They might be BA honors or BSc honors, or for that matter, BCom honors. So back then also, it didn't matter because right from the first subject you studied in a 3-year law course was a law subject. Whereas these days, as in our generation, 5-year law course, for initial few years, they teach you that those bachelor subjects, like for example, I did not do a stereotyped BA/LLB.
Right.
So I did my BB/LLB honors, where I was being taught economics, or for that matter, accounts for initial few years. I had no background of accounting. I didn't know how to make balance sheets. But because I was from a science background, it was very difficult to cope up with all those things. Because obviously, if you are into physics, you know basic calculations. You have studied mathematics till your class 10. So it really doesn't matter as far as as in it personally didn't matter to me. And I know many of my friends who come from various backgrounds, it didn't even matter for them. Like I told you, let me repeat that it only matters for initial few years when those typical pol science and history honor subjects are being taught.
Right.
Otherwise, it doesn't really matter.
True. So, in school times, like you usually have only homework, so we can manage. But once we get into law school, initial 2 years, there's still not a lot of pressures, but going through, we kind of have all these research papers to write. We have these internships. We have a blog which we are managing. The classwork is different. Moot karna hai, ye wo. All this stuff starts getting, like, takes a toll mentally and physically. So, I mean, I have now in my fourth year started to figure out slowly how to balance it. Preeti's in her second year. I assume she's still struggling, like, how to figure out, like, what kind of advice?
Preeti? I was still used to how to multitask and everything. And now, through my second year, I'm still struggling with a lot of things. Like he said, multitude of internships and research papers. How do you suggest law students to strike a perfect balance between everything and still do well in everything?
See, I think law students, and as far as law schools and the pattern of curriculum they follow and the type of education system we are in, I think for a law student who is going to be a lawyer someday and join the profession, even today we have to multitask. I think that is the foundation which law schools deliberately lay down. That is how the curriculum, entire curriculum has been framed to prepare you for the real world outside. Because from 10 a.m. till 4:30 p.m., you are in the court every day where your matter might or might not reach. So you can't just wait there socializing or wasting time. Right. Either you are sitting in the courtroom hearing out what observations the judges are making, what is the judge's viewpoint on a particular issue of law, what is the other counsel arguing, or for that matter, you come across various case laws which might help you in a matter which is pending before you to be drafted. Or you take a pen and paper, start making notes of the matters which you are drafting so that in the evening when you go back to the chamber, you can just hand over that piece of paper to your stenographer and ask him to type out the writ petition or whatever you are drafting. So you can't, as a lawyer also, you just can't wait for the Saturdays and Sundays for you to be free to meet the clients or to do the pending drafting work or to prepare for your final arguments. Similarly, as far as law schools are concerned, I have been there. You can't just leave out on moot courts. You just can't leave out on writing research papers, as well as all these things you can't afford to affect your regular studies. So I think multitasking for a lawyer is very, very essential. And law schools make you deliberately do all this because they want you to be prepared for the real world outside. If you ask for my suggestion, I would say the best way is to get a little disciplined, because when we enter law schools right after class 12, we have that notion of a college life, which turns out to be very, very false and sham after certain number of days in law, because you are just bogged down with everything. So I think just be very disciplined in life and start dividing your time accordingly. You just can't miss out on classes, but at the same time, you have to write research papers and attend moot courts. So like I did for a certain number of years in my law school, I was too focused on participating in moot courts. But later on, I realized by the time I was in my third year, or maybe it was seventh semester or starting of fourth year, that writing of research papers and getting publications is also very important, because all these things add to your CV.
Right.
If you want to join the corporate world and get interviewed by a top tier law firm, CV is something which is going to have the first step towards you getting shortlisted for interview in the very first place. Right. And especially all NLU culture and non-NLU culture which goes on here in the legal fraternity, it is only your CV which is going to make you stand out if you don't come from a top tier NLU especially. I think the only factor which is going to help you multitask is to you getting disciplined and dividing your time accordingly. divide your number of years, say, okay, for first 2 years, I hardly know anything about legal subjects. So I don't see a point going and participating in a national moot court competition. So utilize that time writing research papers on the pressing legal issues. Thereafter, when you have a hang of legal subjects, by the time you are in your third year, start utilizing that time attending moot courts. Because obviously moot courts, and try to focus on moot courts which involve legal issues pertaining to legal subjects which are normally not taught in your 5 year legal curriculum.
Right.
So that gives you an advantage of studying and preparing and making memorials for that moot court by studying that subject, which normally you wouldn't. So I think the only factor is you have to get disciplined, and the sooner you get disciplined, the better it is.
So you mentioned CV, and an ideal CV is something which is an area of concern for all aspiring students who want to get tier one jobs. So how would you describe an ideal set of accomplishments for a law student, and what should he do by the end of 5 years? As in, what accomplishment he have accomplished at the end of 5 years to have a perfect CV?
See, I think when it comes to you applying for jobs after when you're in your fifth year or you're interning and you're applying for your PPOs and the placement offers, I think your school marks are not given that much of weightage. Yeah, obviously you should have a decent score because that is what shows your interest into academics. But obviously, first thing first, your law school marks do really matter. Without a doubt, you should have a really good CGPA. So any sort of compromising on the academics, I think, is not going to take you anywhere. You might be very good when it comes to arguments. You might be very good when it comes to drafting. But see, all these things would not matter when you want to join a typical chamber practice and enter into litigation. I am talking about a good CV from a perspective of a person seeking a corporate job or entering into a litigation department of a corporate law firm.
Right.
So law school marks, obviously a good CGPA is the first eye catcher, should be an first eye catcher. So it should be clearly mentioned. Secondly, extracurricular activities really matter, because a person who has just studied and hasn't done anything in his law school might be an ideal candidate for some, but would not be an ideal candidate for a person like me. I would rather want somebody who is a, say, 8 on 10 CGPA candidate, but is a very good overall personality and a overall individual, having a multitude of experiences with respect to moot courts or, for that matter, legal writing, rather than a person who is 9.5 on 10 CGPA and has done nothing apart from his academics. So yeah, extracurricular, a good balance between an extracurricular and academics is very much required. Internships, take your internships very, very seriously, because I think, again, those are the foundations which is going to shape you in a perfect lawyer in the coming years. You might end up with offices and law firms where days would pass and nobody's going to give you any work. So your proactiveness is very much required. You should go bother the person, whosoever is your reporting officer, to give you work. You just can't sit back and relax. Okay, I've been assigned this work. I have finished this work. Now, unless somebody is going to come on their own and give me work, I'm not going to do anything. So that is absolutely not what is acceptable. You should be very proactive as a lawyer. So yeah, internships, a good balance between your academics and your extracurriculars is what I think should be very clearly highlighted in your CV. CV should be very concise, very, very concise. I have seen CVs wherein there are 5 pages long or 4 pages long. I think a 2-page CV can describe you very well. There's no point if you have like 50 publications at the end of your 50 years, there's no point mentioning all those 50 publications in your CV. Just mention a few on which concern the area of job you are looking into, and you can just leave a footnote or a remark that in case those are required, those can be provided later or something like that. So I think a 2-pager CV, very concise, very crisp, yeah, but that doesn't mean that you would leave on the essential things. Like I told you, there should be a clear highlight about your academics and your extracurricular activities and internships. And just to, because I have come across CVs wherein people say, okay, for this time period to this time period, I have interned as XYZ, or I have interned with XYZ lawyer or XYZ law firm. You should make a note of the work which you have done in every particular internship. Just write maybe just 2 lines on the matters you have worked on, the propositions of law you have researched on. That gives an impression to your potential employer as to how important and how much of attention you have paid all these years while interning.
Right.
So I think if a CV has all those things, it's, according to me, it's a good CV.
Okay. I think that would be very helpful for me personally. I think Preeti and other law students who will be watching this. I wanted to do a little bit talk about, so a lot of people who go into litigation, they don't usually look into going for higher studies like LLM and everything. I think more weightage on experience is given rather than legal knowledge and theoretical knowledge. So what like kind of motivated you to going for an LLM to Cambridge?
Okay, like I told you, nothing in my life so far has gone according to my plan, and so was the case with me pursuing higher studies.
Right.
So it so happened that it was 2016 when me and a very good friend of mine, we decided that we have worked for like 2-3 years now, and anyways, we have to switch over. So it's better that we take a break, maybe apply for a master's degree. And if we get through, it's just a matter of a year. Mm. And after coming back, I'd start afresh. I agree with you on the point that as far as litigation is concerned, LLM or higher studies don't really matter that much. But they indirectly help you a lot. I'll tell you how they indirectly help me and why LLM actually holds a good place when it comes to a litigating lawyer. See, obviously, first thing first, it does add to your CV.
Right.
Secondly, as a part of the Indian education system, we are very accustomed of studying things in a manner which is very stereotyped, I would say. Now, obviously, things are changing. Professors of law schools are obviously very much inclined of giving you various resources to study a particular issue from 10 different books. But still, I think there's a lot of change which is to be required in a law school curriculum. So all this, when I was planning back in 2016, I happened to apply to just 2-3 colleges in UK. And luckily I got through Cambridge.
Right.
But you wouldn't believe that I had the offer letter in my hand and was still in 2 minds whether to go or not, because of the same reason which you mentioned, that I would have to come back and start afresh first thing. There would be a 1-year break in between. Whether it would help me, whether it would not help me, I was in 10 different minds. But ultimately I decided, okay, it's just a matter of a year, and why not try it out? So I went ahead, and I must tell you that the experience was amazing. After coming back, also I doubted whether this year is going to help me in any way pursuing litigation as a career option. See, when you go and do your LLM from these universities, you come into contact with students of 10 different nationalities with 10 different legal backgrounds. You get to sit in a class where the professors are authorities on the subjects. You are being made to study the books which are written by those professors. So obviously it's a different feel altogether and different experience altogether to be taught by that person of whom you have just heard about in your law school. So that way is, it's a very enriching experience, very learning experience. And as far as importance of LLM when it comes to litigation is concerned, I think it does broaden your horizon to a great extent, because when it comes to a litigating lawyer, I think reading and writing are the two very essential things at which you should be very good at. You should be very good at thinking, you should be very good at drafting things, and you should be very good when it comes to articulation and presentation.
Right.
So I think LLM from abroad and especially from these universities does shape your personality in that manner. It gives you a very good experience of reading things, because the curriculum is such that you'll be bogged down under pressure and you would be made to read one particular issue of law from 10 different angles, written by 10 different authors, giving you 10 different interpretations. So that way it helps you a lot as a litigating lawyer as well. But yeah, again, I would not advise anybody to opt for LLM. First of all, if they are looking at LLM from an employability perspective, don't think that obtaining a master's degree is going to enhance your employment perspectives as such. It doesn't. But yeah, obviously, if you want to settle abroad, then it's a different matter altogether. But if you want to come back to India and you think that, okay, I have a master's degree from XYZ University and it is going to help me get an employment in a top tier law firm, it really doesn't, because they are going to discount that number of years which you have spent doing your LLM. So that way, I would say that invest that 1 year into practicing law. That would help you gain experience. But at the same time, I cannot say that 1 year experience is equivalent or is in any way replaceable with that 1 year of LLM experience. LLM experience is way different from what you would experience here practicing law in that 1 year. I think both are very different. So there's no point comparing either of the two. It's a very individual choice. But whosoever wants to pursue LLM, I would always advise that you go for it because you want to experience it. You should not go thinking that it is going to enhance your employment perspective in any way. Obviously, it is going to broaden your horizon, and knowledge in any manner is not going to get wasted ever. So, right. Seek it from wherever you get.
So, going from higher studies, like what I get is ki shouldn't look at it from an employment perspective. Instead, like, if we for ourselves want to experience it, then only we should go for it.
Yeah. So, like, you are in your fourth year, as you just told me. Whosoever is into their fourth years or fifth years, some of the law students I've seen that they start writing their LORs and start applying right from the ninth semester or before the 10 semesters. And they just want to get done with it, directly go and join and pursue LLM right after their law schools. So I am somebody who is not a fan of this sort of practice, because when you go to these Ivy League colleges or for that matter, top law schools of the world, you sit in a classroom with students who are like 10 years of experience.
Right.
But in order to match their mental level, because ultimately you are going to compete with them.
True.
There is no spoon feeding with respect to the professors there. They are going to just upload the reading material. They are going to expect that when you come to the class the next day, you would have gone through that study material and get into a discussion sort of a education system where there is no one-way delivery of lecture. It's right. More of a discussion oriented, which obviously I think is a much better way when it comes to studying law. So I would not suggest somebody to directly go and pursue their LLM right after the law schools, work for some time, clear out your head whether LLM is something which is going to help you in any way or not, and then decide on applying. Because if you rush into it, you would not even get that experience for which you should ideally be going to pursue your LLM.
Right.
Sir, on that note, could you elaborate on Cambridge, and was it difficult for not having prior study experience in the UK? Because the study structure is different from the Indian study system.
Like I told you that I am not a big fan of this practice of directly entering into a law university for pursuing your LLM right after your law school. But at the same time, I think once you are out in the profession working for some number of years and then applying for a LLM and going, although your mental level is obviously much more enhanced, you clearly know in what area of law does your interest lies and you want to specialize when it comes to LLM. But at the same time, you are out of practice of writing papers. You are out of practice of studying, sitting in a classroom for 2 hours and studying.
Right.
Because it's been 3 to 4 years that you have left law school and you are into your profession. So from that perspective, obviously people who go directly after the law schools do have an advantage. But yeah, again, the same thing on a larger perspective, on a broader picture, you really don't know in what area do you want to specialize and where your interest lies. As far as the difficulties which Indian students face and which obviously I also faced, we are not in a habit of studying a particular subject from various resources. The law school curriculum is going to prescribe you one book,
right,
which the teacher will also use, will other your peers are also using, and so you will also use. You are going to write that stereotype answer. You know what type of questions would be asked. You prepare in that manner. You would see last year, previous year's papers, and you are done. You are going to score well. Whereas the pattern of education there is very, very different. They focus much more on broadening your horizon and giving you different views on one single issue from 10 different authors. So take any issue of law, say for example, medical negligence. Now, medical negligence, they would teach you from 10 different books. The class will have a discussion. It will not have one-way delivery of lecture where a teacher would come, open their book, give you notes and leave. There, the study material will be uploaded a day in advance. You would be expected to go through it, because if you don't, then there's no point for you to attend the lecture the next day, because you would not be able to grasp whatever is going on in that lecture for good 2 hours. So they upload the reading material a day in advance or 2 days in advance, categorizing it into different heads, which would say that these are the essential readings, these are the readings which you should do after you are done with your essential readings. Those would have articles, case laws from different authors, different case laws from different legal jurisdictions. So that way, we are not in a habit of doing that, studying in that particular manner. So obviously, for initial few months, you do feel some sort of difficulty with respect to that. But yeah, Indian education system does make us all hardworking fellows. So that way we are able to cope up with that amount of pressure, yeah, and that sort of reading. Because obviously our education system, right from school till your graduation, if it teaches you one thing, that is, I think, working hard.
Hmm.
Maybe not what is required at this point in our. Because right now, I think as far as a lawyer is concerned, you should be a smart reader rather than be somebody who would read each and every line and go, yeah, and write an exam.
So after that, you came into litigation. I was just thinking about that multitasking thing you talked about. So in your litigation career also, you have a huge amount of professional commitments and then you also have your personal commitment. So once you get into litigation, then how do you go about managing these commitments? Like, do you give weight to one more? Like, hey, family is something that I need to take care of before my professional commitment. So how do you go about it?
See, as far as your balance between your professional life and personal life goes, I think as a litigating lawyer, and especially when it comes to initial years of establishing yourself into litigation, it is very difficult to maintain that balance because the competition is such that you just can't relax. You have to work hard. You just can't say no to cases. If a client is calling you on a Sunday evening for a matter which is to be drafted and filed the next day, obviously you have to spend the entire night understanding that matter and drafting it and getting it filed because the agency requires so. And in your initial years as a budding lawyer, you just can't say no to a client. Okay, look, today is Sunday evening. I don't sit in my chamber. So come back to me on a Monday morning. He will not bother engaging you from the next time onwards. He's simply going to go to the another lawyer who is ready and willing to draft that and overnight and getting it filed the next day. So yeah, but that shouldn't stop you from at least striving to maintaining a balance between your personal and professional life, because work is never going to stop. You have to work, but at the same time, you have to take care of your health as well as take care of your family. So work commitments, obviously, for an individual, it's their individual choice. As far as I am concerned, work commitments for me come first.
Right.
Maybe many would not agree with me because for many, family would come first. And I understand and I respect that because it's a very individual choice. But as far as I am concerned, till the time I would not see myself established and reached a particular mark in a legal profession, I think my approach towards work is going to be the same as it is now currently. So, but having said that, I would obviously want that a person, a litigating lawyer, should obviously focus on his health first come first serve, because you spend too many hours applying your mind to something, you have long sitting hours, so it does take a toll on your health. The amount of mental pressure you undergo each day takes a toll on your health, no doubt. So obviously you should take care of your health. You should not compromise on it. Family, obviously, you have to give an adequate time each day to your family. How you balance that is, I think, a very individual choice. I would rather get up at 6 a.m. in the morning and spend time with my family before going to court. Whereas others might just start working at 5 a.m. and wind up their work by like 7 p.m. and come back to their family. So I think it's a very individual choice as to how you maintain your personal and professional life, but it's very, very much required and it's very essential. The sooner you strive to maintain that balance, the better it would be, because as a budding lawyer, things are not in your hand many a times.
Right.
You can't practice law on your terms, at least in the initial starting years. After you have reached a particular stage in your career, where you would say, okay, fine, I am going to take these many matters in a month or in a week, and any number of matters beyond those prescribed limit, I am going to politely refuse to it, because I have to give time to my family as well. But as a budding lawyer, personally, I'm confessing this year that I fail to do that, because sometimes things are not in my hand. I have to work, so I have to work. Right. And I think your parents, your family, when they agree to you joining the profession, they somewhere agree to your life like this.
Yeah.
So many long hours of working. And it's not about a litigating lawyer. I think even for people who are into corporate world, who are into law firms, working like this and having too many long hours of working is a part of their life as well.
The common theme that comes up during a study of law, and as you mentioned, litigation is a concept of justice. And I feel judiciary in law is more of a concept, whereas justice is more abstract. So how would you say we wrap our heads around what would be an ideal and realistic to approach law as a career?
See, I think when it comes to practicing law, you should just focus on your sincerity towards work. You should be very open and fair to your client. If a client comes to you, he comes to you and bestows his confidence and faith in you. So you as a lawyer and your professional ethics demand that you place before him the clear picture of his case. Where does his case stand? Even if he has a weak case or there are not much chances of he succeeding, you should give him a clear picture of all those weak points. See, when a client comes to you, he knows the stronger points. But as a lawyer, I think it's your professional duty to tell him where his case is lacking, what are the weaker points on which there would be a lot of objection when it comes to the hearing of that matter. So as a lawyer, I think it's your professional duty to give the client a honest picture of his case. Do not hide or give any sort of false expectations to your client, because those false expectations today are going to bite you tomorrow as a lawyer, because lawyers' success or failure depends a lot on a good word of mouth. If a client is satisfied with you, he's going to go and tell this to 10 different people who might be a potential clients to you. So, as a lawyer, I think it's your professional duty to honestly tell your client where his case lacks. Secondly, when it comes to drafting his petition, I think my mentors have always told me this, that you should disclose everything in black and white. Whatever points you as a lawyer think are also not going to be in favor of your client should be mentioned clearly, and then it depends on your advocacy skills to tackle those weaker points before the court of law. Because if you are going to hide things, they would not be actually hidden and they would come up not today but tomorrow during the course of arguments.
Right.
The defense is not going to leave any stone unturned to bring out those points which are not in your favor, because obviously he has to do his job. So I think it's better that you mention all those points beforehand in your petition and then use your advocacy skills to tackle those. I think that should be the mantra for a good drafted petition and for a good lawyer. Because see, client communication is one thing which I think the law schools should focus on a lot. Because if you don't know how to deal with your clients, because this is something which no internship is going to teach you, no lawyer is going to teach you. This you will only learn when you start your own practice, when you have your own clients to deal with. What to say and what not to say is something which a lawyer should understand. You should know when to keep shut before the client as well as before the court of law. But that shouldn't stop you from telling your client what is and is not in his favor.
Sir, I know you are primarily a civil practitioner, but if we talk about the criminal side of things, in my internships, I've seen that lying during the defense about facts, about things to save your client is quite prevalent. So does that, how does that go with our moral code and our justice? Is there any mantra that you would have there?
See, I agree that people do resort to these sort of practices of not disclosing things, suppression of facts, concealment. But then the law with regard to this is settled, that ones who approaches the code should approach the code with clean hands.
Right.
Now you can see this from two different perspectives. Person who is clean, why will he approach the court of law? First thing, he must have done something. That is the reason he has come to you for saving him, right? But if you see it from a different perspective and you apply a different interpretation altogether, clean hands doesn't mean that you should be clean altogether, as in you should be clean in your acts. You have done something, that is the reason the law is behind you, and that is the reason you have come here to engage a lawyer to represent you. But whatever you are stating should be very crisp, very crystal, very, very clear. You should not see molding of facts and interpreting a thing which might favor you is permissible. That is what I think the advocacy is. You have to mold the facts and you have to interpret a thing which is going to favor your client. You have to resort to that interpretation which is going to favor your client's case. But mentioning something wrong, mentioning something which has not happened, mentioning something which your client hasn't told you on your own, I think as a lawyer, you should refrain from doing all this, because see, you as a lawyer strictly act on the instructions given by you to your client.
Right.
So obviously the client is not going to understand the nitty-gritties of law. He will come and present you with the facts. How you write those facts depends upon you and your drafting skills, that it suits and favors your client's case. But at the same time, you are not expected to conceal things. Say that, okay, the law in this regard is settled and it says XYZ things. But in my case, XYZ things haven't happened. But then you resort to a different interpretation and interpret that XYZ things with respect to which the law is settled and apply that interpretation which suits your case. So I would personally not advise anybody to conceal things. Be very clear, because that gives you a different confidence altogether when you're presenting your case. Okay, you are saying this, I have already written this in my petition on such and such page, on such and such paragraph, and this is how I'm going to deal with this. Rather than be shocked and surprised when the defense is going to bring out something. And obviously, some things are not in your control. If your client hasn't disclosed complete facts to you, you're not expected to write everything in your petition. If tomorrow the opposite counsel is bringing out something which is a fact which you are not aware of, which your client hasn't disclosed it to you, then the ideal way to go around it is just confess this before the court of law, seek time to consult your client, and then come back next day.
Yeah.
Rather than bluffing around.
Yeah. That's a quite apt thing to do. Yeah, that's a good moral code to have, I think.
For several upcoming lawyers, having a mentor is very important. So as you mentioned, all the details of how to mitigate, how to have moral responsibility as well as do your job correctly. So how do you give advice on the importance of having a mentor, and who do you consider as your mentor?
See, I think it's entirely based on one's luck. You sometimes land up in chambers and in law firms with such teams and with such partners who are going to support you throughout everything in your career. Even in times when you are not really associated professionally with them, they're going to refer you cases. They are going to help you out with any sort of help which you need. And so I think I have been lucky to have such mentors in my life all throughout, right from the time I have joined the profession till date. But having said that, I know people who were not lucky to have such mentors. Because some people have a very professional way of looking at things. They don't want to associate with you once you are not with them professionally. So I think law is a profession where, as a lawyer, you will have to have good mentors. If you're not comfortable working with somebody, I think there's no point continuing to work there. Switch over. You have many options. Nobody can really teach you how to practice law. You have to gain your own experience. But yeah, when you want to see an ideal mentor, I think you should look for places where there's plenty of work and not too many people and not too able hands to cater to those sort of matters. Because there you would get the first hand work, first thing. You would have ample opportunity to work hard and get into good books of your senior. Because getting into good books of your senior is going to not just help you with getting a lot of work, but even if when you go independent and you are not really associated with your senior, he is going to refer you clients. So that way, law is a profession where you have to build contacts. You have to socialize. You have to build contacts. You just can't rely on one person and sit down that, okay, he or she is my godfather or godmother who is going to help me sail throughout my life. Right. You have to meet people. You have to be very outgoing. You can't be very reserved. So an ideal mentor and an ideal place to work for a person who's just starting into profession, I think, should be where there are not too many people, as in not too many subordinates to a senior, and where there is too much of work. Because if there is not work, you will not be able to experiment with anything. Maybe initial few cases you are going to give him drafts which might come back on your face, but then you will have ample opportunity to improve, because there are so many matters to work upon. Secondly, if you happen to land up in a place where there are too many subordinates to a senior, you as a young professional is going to become a junior to those subordinates. So basically you come in third in the hierarchy. Your interaction with the senior would be absolutely nil, because you would be working for his subordinate. So that way, I think you should be very careful while choosing where you want to work and where you want to start with.
Just on that point, where I want to work and what kind of legal, law is a very varied field, cyber law, this law, that law. Even in my fourth year, I've just now started to somehow realize this is what my calling is, perhaps this is what I'm interested in. So how do you feel like a law student should go about realizing what he is passionate about? How can he find that something, some field that he's passionate about?
See, I think all this should start when you choose to apply for your internships. Because I think internships for a law students are something which are going to give you that practical experience which law books will not be able to, and your law school teachers will not be able to. So choosing your internships wisely is the stepping stone towards understanding what interests you. If you have worked during your first internship on, say, matters pertaining to constitutional law, try to arrange for an internship, the second internship, where they are working on some different aspects of law altogether. For example, say IPR, or for example, say competition law or antitrust laws. So by the time you are in your 10th semester, or for that matter, 9th semester, and you have done, say, 7-8 internships, I think that would give you a good understanding of what interests you. If you have worked on, say, 5 different laws or 6 different laws in 6, 7, 8 internships, I think that would give you a clearer picture of what interests you. And that would not happen if you would keep continuing interning at places where there is same quality of work, same nature of work. So I think internships are very important when you want to clear your head of what you actually want. And of course, secondly, when different subjects are taught in your law school, I think that gives you a little sense of what interests you, because studying a particular subject which interests you will not come to you as a burden. You would want to interest more. Your inquisitiveness toward that subject would be more. You would want to Google up the current legal issues and current legal developments in that particular subject of law. So I think you should be able to understand those little indications of your interest. Try to choose internships according to those interests. And then obviously, initial few years are there for you to experiment. Nobody expects you that right after passing out of law school, you would end up somewhere where you would continue throughout your life. You would want to join a place, see if that particular place, what nature of work, what type of work is there, which interests you. If it doesn't, you always have a choice to switch over.
So this internship part is something I usually struggle with. Like, okay, I am interested in tribal laws, I am interested in IPR, but do I go about doing different type of internships? Like, do I try out a in-house corporate, a law firm, a litigation, or do I go for internships which offer me these specific subjects that I'm interested in?
Yeah, I think if studying cyber law interests somebody in law school as a subject, that particular individual, that particular student should focus on tweaking his CV so as to give an impression that he has a little something for cyber laws. So that particular individual can write research papers on issues concerning cyber laws. That particular individual might want to enroll for diploma and certificate courses pertaining to cyber laws. That particular individual can look out for places where the primary work concerns cyber laws and offenses related to cyber laws. Obviously, I don't think so there would be any particular law firm or for that matter a particular law chamber where the practice is only of cyber laws. But yes, there would be law firms where they would have teams which might have some work, some sort of clientele dealing with cyber laws. And there would be law chambers where they must have represented clients pertaining to issues of cyber laws. So look out for those chambers, research, and then apply for internships in such sort of chambers, because that would give you a clearer picture. Because as a law student, cyber laws might interest you as a subject.
Right.
But it might not interest you practicing.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to have a clearer picture with respect to both. Okay, academics interest me, but does the practical aspect of that particular subject also interest you? So, and that you can only find out interning.
Internships, yeah.
Yeah.
Preeti, any questions you have?
I'm in my second year and I got to know so much from you, sir. I'm really grateful to you.
Anytime, you can contact me anytime with any sort of help you need professionally. And good luck to both of you. I think law culture is going to do good with your and people heading you. And whatever help you require from me, I'm always there. Good luck.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for this session.
Thank you.
Well, we have more episodes coming soon, varied themes and people. So be sure to subscribe to The Law Culture and not miss out any new episode. Thank you.
Bye, sir.
Bye.
Bye.